Prophesy. That it is, that it cuts, slices through. It is more powerful than a two-edged sword. To speak it into your situations this morning. But you know, as we go into our worship time this morning, we're going to take communion. And this is why Jesus died, so that we would have the power and authority. All the power and authority of heaven could be given to us through Jesus. He took our punishment so that we could live in the freedom. I was just mulling over that these last few days. And we know it, don't we? Because, you know, we regularly come to communion and we regularly just focus on the fact that Jesus died for our sins so that we wouldn't have to take the punishment. But when you lump us in with everybody else on the universe, that means that Jesus stood in front of his Father and he said, "That murderer, don't punish him, punish me. That rapist, don't punish him, punish me. That liar, don't punish him, punish me. That cheat, don't punish him, punish me. That one who is selfish, that one who is turning away from me, that one who is lying, that one who is constantly doing the same thing over and over again, even though they've been challenged on it." You see, we come. same category. We are the liar, we are the cheat. We are those that are selfish. We are those that have wandered. We are those that don't receive the challenge. We keep going around the mountain and we stand alongside the murderer and the rapist. Because in the sight of God, sin is sin. He died once and for all. And that's a humbling thing to think, that we stand alongside those whose crimes and sins we seem to feel is so much worse than ours. And God looks down and he sees no difference. Because Jesus pleaded with his Father, don't punish them. Punish me. He took the punishment for us so that we might live in the freedom, so that we might live in the grace, so that we would have all power of heaven and authority to use for his glory. So thank you is never enough, is it? The biggest thank you that we could give you, Lord, is to demonstrate what you mean to us in our lives. For you to flow through us, Father, every time we open our mouths, every time we make a decision, every time we find ourselves up against a difficult situation, Father, may we demonstrate you, the one who took our punishment. So Father, as we worship you this morning, will you accept the praises of your people in this place? Father, as we open ourselves up to you and maybe feel vulnerable before you, will you come and heal? Lift. Father, will you bring peace into troubled souls this morning? Father, will you wash clean once again as we come and we say, Father, we are so sorry for the things that we know that we've done that are wrong. But we want to say sorry for the things we weren't even aware of. Those thought patterns, those actions. Lord, we thank you today for your forgiveness, the power of forgiveness that washes us clean, which allows us to come boldly before your throne this morning, to worship you, to adore you, to magnify your name in this place. Holy Spirit, you're welcome here. Sweep through this place with your power. For you, I We surrender to you, Lord.
Jesus.
dry bones, Lord.
Jesus.
Speak your name over those dead areas. Bring them to life, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord.
Jesus.
Church is for, to come together, to praise, to worship, to receive. Come on, give me another applause. This is the God, this is the Jesus, this is the Jesus who hung on that cross and died for each and every single one of us. Amen? Amen. If you want to just take your seats a moment. We've got to remember that. We've sung it this morning. We've sung about having an encounter with God, an encounter with Jesus this morning. Who wants that? You're standing there in worship. You're praising. Your arms are lifted. Your eyes are closed. You're singing. You're crying out. And you're saying, God, I want an encounter. I want you. That has to make your heart move. Anyone struggling. We've got people in the house today who are hurting. We've got people in the house who are struggling with health. We've got financial issues. We've got relationship issues. We've got every issue that the world faces right here in our house. And God is saying, I'm here. I've got you. Come and have an encounter with me this morning. Come to me, my child. Come to me. Open up. Lay your burden down. Lay it down. I'm going to pick it up. My yoke is light. Walk with me. I am your Savior. I am your God. I've got you. I've got you. I'm not letting go. Who doesn't want that? So this morning, as we're moving into our offering, we've got to remember that giving is who we are. Giving is what we do. It's simple as that. And all through the Bible, it talks about generosity and how generosity is the difference maker. Every story you read in the Bible, generosity is all through. And we can all be generous with whatever we have, whether or not it's the smallest thing or the largest thing. God knows. God knows who we are. God knows our heart. Sometimes we get hung up on tithing. This week I was drawn to Matthew 23:23, where Jesus is really, really giving the Pharisees a hard time. No meek and mild there. He's really, really, really challenging them about the hypocrisy. And he touches very briefly on tithing. And it's just such a, that's what you do. That's your baseline. That's simples. You know, that's just that. Let's just get on with that. I'm not really worried about that. You know, that's the easy bit. The bit he's interested in is that generosity, that lifestyle of generosity. If tithing is about that new beginning, that new start, each day, each week, each month, each year, then generosity is about the walk in the path and taking the next step and the next step and the next step and seeing what God has got in store for you. Seeing those heavenly storehouses open. Seeing your path made straight through his eyes. Who doesn't want that? Come on, who doesn't want that? We're too quiet this morning. Who doesn't want that in the house? Who doesn't want to see God break through in their house? Who doesn't want to see a financial miracle this morning? Who doesn't want to see a health miracle? Who doesn't want to see that family member that's been crying out to God for years and years and years, right here in this house, standing with them, praising, celebrating, hearing the word, seeing their lives change from the inside out? Who doesn't want that? Come on, church, who doesn't want that? Come on. We've got to get this. We've got to get this generous spirit in our heart, because when it's in our heart, it will flow out of us in every act that we do, whether or not it's a financial act, whether or not it's a relationship or a time or anything. It will just come out of us, and someone on the street will say, wow, what's that person got? And that's it. We are that light, and that generosity is that light, because people will see Jesus through us, through the acts that we take. And God is saying, I've got you back. Just keep going. Be generous. Be generous with what you have, and more will come, and more will come, and more will come, and you'll never be without, because we're not here to live in lack, we're here to thrive. Who wants to thrive this morning? Who wants God to help them thrive this morning? Who's been struggling financially this morning? Who wants to say, God, I'm going to lay it with you this morning. I want to see that breakthrough. I want to see that new house. I want to see that car. I want to see the ability to be able to buy some petrol for the person behind me in the car park. Who doesn't want that? Who doesn't want to go to a restaurant one evening and say, right, I've got this. My God has blessed me and I've got this. Your bills are paid. Amen. Amen. These are the acts that people will look at and go, wow. But so will the act of just spending some time chatting to that person at the bus stop. Coming alongside somebody who may be having a tough day. And just sharing a word, just having a chat. That's generosity as well. And we've got to practice that. Because drawing people, connecting with people is how church grows. And God will create those opportunities, and there will be more opportunities this week. We need to take hold of them. We've got the Italian Gardens Destiny Live event coming up in a couple of weeks. And I've got to encourage you all as church to be there on that Saturday morning at 11 o'clock. We're going to want everybody there for as long as possible to spread the word by saying, look, hi, I'm here. I'm with Destiny Church. We're over there. This is what we do. Come. Come see. Come listen. Come and listen. This is what we do. We want you all here. And you're crucial to this church. You really are. Because every single one of us, the more people that we have down with us in those Italian gardens, drawing folks in, a crowd draws the crowd. If we're there and we are responding to the band as they are leading worship, then people will be drawn. They will look, wow, what are they doing? And they will come in closer. And then we'll be able to break out. We'll be able to say, look, let me share a bit more with you. Here's a card. We're at Priory Church on tomorrow morning. Bring your kids. It's an awesome day. We've got Easter egg hunt. This is it. This is us doing outreach, and it's going to change the town. It's going to take time, effort. We've got to be generous with ourselves. We've got to be generous with our finances to make it work. We've got to be generous with our time to be there. Amen? Who's with me on that? Come on, we've got to give God an amen. This is us taking church to town. This is us going to where the people are, and we are saying, Lord, we are outreaching. We are doing what you called us to do, and we know that you will bless that. We are all going to do our part. Amen? Amen. Amen. So we're made to be generous. We are made to bless. Who loves to bless other people? Who loves to give someone a present? Come on, we all must do. I challenge anyone who's got their hand down, is that we're obviously not giving enough people presents. But when you give people gifts, you see their face. You see that response. You see that surprise sometimes. And then you get that warm feeling inside. And you think, wow, that was nice. And then you think, well, why did I do that? And actually, why did I feel like that? And actually, it's because we're blessed to be a blessing. We feel good when we bless other people. God set that up. So if we bless, we will feel blessed. And we will see more resources come in to bless more. So I would encourage anybody, find a way to bless somebody this week. However big, however small. Find a way to do it. Buy someone a cup of coffee. Give them a chocolate bar or something at work when they look like they're struggling. Find a way to do it. And be amazed about God, how God will take that. And he will open that, and that will lead on to something else. We celebrated communion this morning, all about coming together. coming together and saying, God, we remember. We remember what you did at that Last Supper. We remember we took the blood, we took the bread, and we stood together and we sang. And that's so, so significant, because we are saying, God, on this solid ground we stand. On this solid ground of communion, we stand. We stand here with you. We stand here as part of your church. We stand here to see your church grow. We stand here to be the lights to shine to the community. We stand here to bless the community. We stand here to do miracles in the community, because we are here to do greater things than Jesus did. All those amazing miracles in the Bible, we are here to do greater things than that. That spirit is in each and every one of us. Generous with what God has given us. Generous with that spirit. Got to be courageous enough to take that step out and say, I will do it, because God will be right behind you. Say, yes, finally they've got it. Wow, we are on our way. God is there. He is ready. He's so ready. He's itching for us to step out and start doing things. He really is. And remember, with generosity, I think the key thing we can take away from this is generosity is not about a Sunday. Sunday is where we can come together and have a fabulous time in the house. But the week is where the people are. The week is where we need to be generous. That's where we need to be with people. That's where we need to be working out how we can be generous with the people around us in each of our circles of life, whether or not it's at work, at home, or ever. We need to find ways to be generous. So let's take a moment to pray. Lord, thank you so much for this great honor and privilege to be able to come together as your church and praise you and worship you and celebrate you. Thank you so much. Thank you so much for creating that space. Lord, we just want to pray as we take up our offering this morning. We lift it up to you. However big, however small, we lift it with a generous heart. And we say, God, work inside me. Change me from the inside out, Lord. I want to be able to bless more. I want to be able to be more generous. I want to have anything that I've put in my own life that is an obstacle to be this, to be taken away, to be washed away, as Pastor Lois said earlier, so I can be open to you, to your purpose for my life. I want to see those miracles come true. I want to see those breakthroughs happen. I want us to be out in the church, in the community, and I want to see us changing this town for you. And I'm praying ahead of our Destiny Live event, I'm praying that we will have an amazing transformation in this town on that day as we go to the center of town and we put our feet on the ground and say, we are here, 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 we are here. Amen. Amen. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, God. Amen. Thank you, Jesus. And as we're taking up our offering this morning, keep an eye on the screens about the great stuff we've got coming up here at Destiny Church. Thank you.
Hello, people. Welcome to Destiny Church, the church with a difference. This is D-Live, where we help you catch up on activities of the church. Let's have a listen to the announcements.
It's time for the Easter blessings. Time for blessing our cat clients with Easter eggs. Loads of Easter eggs. We want to do it. We've done it in previous years. We just want to bless them and bring them loads of Easter eggs. So if you can bring some Easter eggs along to Destiny Church by Sunday the 7th of April, just bring your Easter eggs along. We will promise that we will take care of them, and we will put them together into amazing packages that we can deliver to our cat clients. And I have to say, having delivered them in the past, they are such an amazing blessing, and the reaction that we get is just fantastic. There are often tears and all sorts of emotions. So it's your chance to take part and to bring some Easter eggs along. Thanks very much.
I'm sure that you will agree that Easter is a great opportunity to tell people about how much God loves them. That Jesus came, he died, he rose again for them, and so that they can have a great life and a hope and a future for eternity. How amazing. And so we want to make sure that we get out and about to tell people about that. And so on Saturday, the 20th of April, we're going to be right here in the centre of town on the town square, letting people know about that. The band are going to be playing, and we want everybody to join us so that we can personally invite people that are in town that day to join us in church on Sunday. So make sure you put it in your diaries, keep it free. It's going to be 11 till 1. You do not want to miss it, and we are going to pray that that is going to be an incredible day that makes a difference to our town and to the kingdom of God and our church.
on the 21st of April, we're going to be celebrating Easter here at Destiny Church. It's going to be a great event, lots of fun, and a great time to remember the real reason for the season. Bring your friends, bring your family, and let's raise the praise in the house on the 21st.
On Easter Sunday, the kids are going to also going to have a great time because they are doing, can you guess, an Easter egg hunt!
The next guys event is coming up on Friday the 26th of April. It's going to be a great time. Watch this space for more information.
The next Connect Breakfast is going to be on Saturday, the 27th of April. Make sure you put that date in your diary and watch this space for more details.
And that's everything for now. Enjoy the experience and afterwards, have a cup or two at Decaf as you catch up with old friends and new ones.
And the thing is that when the devil's lies start making more sense than God's truth, we're in trouble. Let's destroy arguments that have the potential to destroy us before they get settled in our minds and start touching our hearts and changing our hearts. Let's just destroy the argument. See, whenever we're wronged, let's always check we're thinking right. So let's always use our imagination in a positive way to create good thoughts and think better things. Let's understand this. The Bible always fits, even when we don't like its style, because it never goes out of fashion. Our beliefs are so important because they guide our present, they align our past, and they direct our future. So let's not allow our emotions to run rife and control life. You see, sound minds cause people to respond, whereas impulsive thoughts cause people to react. So we're going to think positively. We're going to think really good thoughts. We're going to think with expectation. We're going to be excited about living for God. We're going to be always thinking the best and not the worst. We're always going to be thinking good and not bad. That's going to be the way that we and the next generation is going to think, because I'm not going to give any time anymore. I gave too much time to negative thinking. Come on, let's give God praise in the house this morning for his word that we're about to receive. Father, we thank you for your word. We thank you, Lord, that you know what we need to hear today. And Father, we thank you that this is an opportunity for us to change. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. I want to get straight into this today and don't want to waste any time kind of recapping. So straight in, I think that might have been the recap from 2 weeks ago, but you know what we shared last week. Unless I'm going mad, I thought, I'm sure that's not the recap from last week, but I could be going mad, folks. It's been a long week. Pray for me. Anyway, you know that we were talking last week about arguments, and so we're going to go in to the next level today. And before we do that, I just want to welcome people on Facebook. I want to welcome people on YouTube and say it's great to have you with us. And if you're tuning in for the first time, would you let us know and we'll give you a shout out on those social media platforms. So today we're finishing the series. And then next week is going to be our dedication Sunday, where we are dedicating 3 children to the Lord. So that's going to be an exciting time in the house. There's going to be a lot of people here next week. So make sure that you invite others. It's going to be very low-key but evangelistic. Okay, so it's going to be one of those Sundays. If you want to invite someone as an introduction to church, as an introduction to the Lord, I think that Sunday will be a great Sunday to do that and support the families of the children that are being dedicated in the house next week. It's so exciting dedicating children because, you know, these youngsters, these babies are that next generation. And they're going to be leading this church. And they're going to be taking this vision forward with the other kids in our church. And it's so exciting to think about that, that this church doesn't finish when we transition to heaven, but actually it continues with the next generation. I wonder who's going to be pastor when I'm gone. I wonder. It's going to be interesting. I bet it will be someone you didn't think would be a pastor. Always the way, always, because I always thought that too. So we're going to finish this series, and we've been hearing over the weeks that as we think, so we are. And we've discovered so much about how our thinking really does affect our lives, and even more importantly, our health. So with that in mind, let's look at level 4 of the 4-level thought process, as we've covered level 1, which was thoughts, level 2, that were high things, and level 3, that were arguments. And our key scripture for the very last time is 2 Corinthians 10 and verse 4, where it says, "For the weapons of our warfare are not carnal, but mighty in God for pulling down strongholds, casting down arguments, and every high thing that exalts itself against the knowledge of God, bringing every thought into captivity to the obedience of Christ." Shows us a 4-level thought process. Thoughts, high things, arguments, and strongholds. So let me, for the very last time, put my thought lift operator hat back on and say to you, welcome, ladies and gentlemen. So now we're going up to the most dangerous level of the thought process. And believe me, it's not a good place to go or to be. Honestly, it's not pleasant up there. But what would I know? I'm just your humble elevator operator, your messenger, and I'm at your command. So we'll go up to level 4 and we'll take a look. And on this level, we have strongholds, we have bad habits, we have stinking attitudes, we have misplaced values and huge egos, with a special buy one, get one free offer in our serious addictions department. Ladies and gents, you might not know how you got there, but I think I have some idea. It all started with a thought. And whilst we're here, I want to be your personal tour guide and show you around in order to help you find your way back down and never get back to that place ever again. So let's go into strongholds. So here's the thing. It all starts with a thought. It all starts with a thought. And before we go into any kind of thinking today about how this message would be so applicable if so-and-so from our family was here, or so-and-so from our workplace was here, or one of our friends, or that guy that we bumped into the other day, or bumped into us and had an attitude, and you're thinking right now, if only they were in church today, because they need to hear this message. Let's also realize that God wants us to hear something today. Remember, the thought was only 4 levels down. And that was the stage where we had the thought, and we also had the opportunity to deal with the thought by evaluating it. And this is a reminder that we have to become better thought elevators. Sorry, evaluators, not elevators. Evaluators. We have too many E's in the message today. I've just made it worse by putting this statement in. Let's evaluate what we elevate. Let's become better thought evaluators, not better thought elevators. Let's evaluate every thought. Let's evaluate its potential. Does it have the potential to help us or to harm us, to better us or to bitter us? Where will, here's a question we need to ask about every thought that we have. Where will it take me? Because here's the thing. One of the most common traits that lead people to level 4 thinking, along with level 3 arguments, is curiosity. And we all know the potential danger and that curiosity killed the cat. We have a cat down our road. I think he's had 12 lives. He always seems to run out when we're driving down. I saw a bird that obviously curiosity of a piece of food across the road kind of took the better of them, and they went under my car and out the other side. How many of you know that sinking feeling when you're driving, you see the bird, it goes under your car, and you're thinking, no, I went for the crunch, and then it flies off the other side. There's some daredevil birds in our village, I tell you. Curiosity killed the cat. So let me say this, it's better to stay curious than to enter curiosity's playground. Because this playground has another name, captivity. And curiosity captivates captives. And isn't it sad that human nature is that we are more curious about exploring bad than experiencing good? I was thinking of Ethan right then and how he's so curious. But he's curious about doing the wrong things. Yeah. But he's learning what's right and wrong. The thing is, when he knows it's wrong, he still goes back and does it because curiosity just gets the better of him. And he's waiting for the reaction and that little word, no. And he'll push, and he'll push. And all four of us, his parents and us, we look at each other and we go, where did he get that from? Original sin. Right there. No one's taught him to do that. No one's been around him as a little mentor, a little, you know, little mentors that are a little bit older, like little brothers and sisters. He doesn't have little brothers and sisters. He has older brothers and sisters. And hopefully they're not teaching him that. But, you know, he's not learning that from anybody else. That's inside of him. That's what original sin does. And so you can see this curiosity. If I do that, isn't that us? Curiosity captivates captives. And we're curious about exploring bad more than we are experiencing good. So let me give you the lowdown of level four thinking. And the first element, which is strongholds. This is kind of the level that we're on, but it's also the first thing that I want to talk about on this level, because there's various things on this level within the category of strongholds. So a stronghold is something that captured your attention and now has captured you. Or put another way, it now has control of you and you're no longer in control of it. In other words, whereas you or I were once the master of our thoughts, we're now the slave because they've mastered us. And it's a wake-up call. Let's never become enslaved by the thoughts we once mastered. Let's never become enslaved by the thoughts we once mastered. What happened? That scripture comes to mind. I haven't got it on here because it's just come to mind. And Dave can work fast, but not that fast. But here's the scripture. Who cut in on you? Yeah. See, you were once thinking straight. Why is it now that the thought that you once mastered, you controlled that thought. You didn't let it take you places. You didn't let it take you where you didn't want to go. Now it's taking you there. You don't even know you're going there. So a minor thought has now become a major stronghold and is dominating us, enslaving us, controlling us, preoccupying us. Life is now centered around this stronghold. And this level is where the second element starts to develop, because habit forming begins. Here's a definition of habits: routines of behavior that are repeated regularly and tend to occur subconsciously without one being conscious about them. In other words, you do them because it's become part of you. It's not your original identity, but you're just doing it now because that's what your life has become. It's centered around this stronghold. It's centered around this habit. By the way, can I just throw this in? We've all got bad habits.
Yeah.
Just turn to the person next to you and say, we're in good company today. I didn't get you to tell them that they had a bad habit. Thought that might not have been wise. You never know when that flesh is going to start to respond or react. In other words, we don't even realize that we've adopted these habits and are doing them. And remember, that's because of what we said in the last couple of points, how common sense has disappeared and our conscience is being eroded. And it's alarming how easily a specific thought can cause particular behavior to become everyday routine and form recurring habits. It's so easy. It's so easy. So let's capture thoughts before they change behaviors, become routines, and form habits. Let's capture our thoughts before they change behaviors, become routines, and form habits. Because if we don't, the recurring habit will become our life standard, because it becomes our lifestyle. Bitsby. I'm sure she's working for the other side. And you know what this will ultimately do is control where we go, what we do, how we do it, and who we do it with. Because that's what our stronghold does. It starts to change where we spend our life, who we spend our life with, because now we're looking for people who will entertain our strongholds. Oh, there will always be those that love us, that will be around us, whatever, but there will be those that have walked away from us because they don't like the way that our thoughts are making us, but there will also be other people that will quite easily and happily take you in to their stronghold so that you, as birds of a feather, can flock together. So accompanying us on this journey at this level is the third element, stinking attitudes. And that's because stinking attitudes are cousins of bad habits. And I believe pride is the great grandfather of stinking attitudes. And stinking attitudes have a mother called misplaced values. Because at this level, there's no sense of true values. Morality is slipping away fast because there's little sense of right and wrong. And then there's the big daddy. Let's not forget the big daddy of them all, called huge ego. And in the words of a bygone girl band, when we're on level 4, we need to have a sit down with our ego. Because now we truly believe that we're all that and a bag of chips. And what does anyone else know? Because no one else's opinion matters. And here's the real problem. At this level, no one's able to get close to the real you anymore. Because you have isolated yourself on level 4 and you no longer want to know the opinion of anybody else, because no one else has a valid opinion, because your opinion counts. You're right all the time, and all the time you are right. Some of you are thinking names right now. You work with someone like that this week, and you know someone in your family and you can't get through anymore. Maybe they're on level 4. Maybe this thought has become a stronghold. You can't get through anymore. But my point in sharing this is not to get you to think of other people, but actually to make sure that you don't go there. And if there is any element of you being there, come back down today. I feel like I'm doing like this diva move here. I'm so passionate about it today. I was watching Babs busting his moves before the service. That's what I've caught the same vibe. I need to, I tell you. This is also where we meet another two members of the Level 4 family, and they are the ugly twin sisters called Serious Addictions. And when they really grab you, well, they've well and truly got you. And Level 4 is the place where addictions are fostered and habits are formed. And you know something? The following serious addictions all started with a thought, like, I need a cigarette. I need a drink. I need a joint. Don't know whether that's the way they say it anymore. Let's say, I need drugs. That all started with a thought. And these examples are not the only ones about serious addictions, because believe me, before we get on our high horse about it, you know, there are many other serious addictions that we entertain in our own lives, thinking that everybody else has got a problem with addiction, not us. We could be addicted to a past way of living that we just will not change. It's become a habit. We are that way. We even say, that's the way I am. And if you don't like it, lump it. It's like, well, you're on Level 4 then, because now that thought, that way of life, that way, whatever it was, the way you brought up, something that happened in your past, now that's dominating your life, you're excusing the way you are, your behaviors, because, well, that's just the way I am. Well, it's not the way you need to be. It's not the way I need to be. I've got to change. I'm a work in progress. The Holy Spirit is changing me from day to day. It's transforming me from glory to glory. Do I have any takers in the house today? Come on. Yeah. I'm meant to be changing. I'm meant to be capturing those thoughts. Do I do it? Do you want me to have a little honest moment with you? Do I do it all the time? No. So we are in good company. We all think things we shouldn't think, and that leads to say things that we shouldn't say and do things that we shouldn't do. But at least we're honest. We're not trying to hide it. At least we're out there saying, do you know what? Yeah, I, as a pastor, I think things I shouldn't think. I'm glad you're not in my mind, because you might not come to church. Because you have this idea of how I should be. I'm sorry, I'm going to let you down all the time. I mean, Jesus is the only one that's perfect. So just focus on him when you're thinking about me. I'm not trying to put any thoughts in your mind, by the way, because now you go, ooh. What the pastor might really think? You don't want to even go there. Come on, I'm a man. I'm a human being. Jesus was the only one that could really deal with that and stay pure and stay right and stay perfect. Sorry guys, but your pastor is not Jesus. I try to be like him as much as I can, but sometimes I fall down and fail. But I'm glad we're together. And if you think that you're not on that level, good for you. Let me pray for you. I don't even know where I got to. I'm having a confession time up here. So we talked about, you know, these things that can become addictions, and they all started with the same. Do you know what? Our same things that we keep making allowances for and asking other people to make allowances for all started with the same thing that the drug addict started with the alcoholic. We had that thought, I need. And it was a misguided thought, because we thought it would satisfy our need and gratify our longing. And the truth is, we did have a need to satisfy and a longing to gratify. But where we look for satisfaction and gratification makes all the difference, because Jesus is the only one who can truly satisfy and really gratify. If only we would go to Jesus. If only we would go to God. If only we would go to God's word when we have thoughts, rather than allowing our minds to race away somewhere else. It says to bring that thought down, to capture that thought. Bring it under the knowledge of God. Bring it into the knowledge of God. What you know of what God would say about you in this situation right now, thinking what you're thinking, bring it into that environment. Jesus was and Jesus is our answer to every need and every longing that we will ever have. So here's the deal. The enemy lied to us that things would be the answer. High things, wrong things, bad things, all got in the way of the main thing. And the truth is that to get down from this level, we really do need help. We need the help of a friend. Because the reality is that most people can't even get themselves back in the elevator, let alone press the button to go back down. In fact, think about it. Because of the fact that it means that you have to back down from where you're at. I mean, think about this. We've got huge ego. So we're talking about the person that's trying to get back in the elevator, and we've got huge ego whose head won't fit through the door. We've got stinking attitudes who keep saying, "What's your problem?" because they believe everybody else is the problem. We got misplaced values who think, hey, live and let live, because a little bit of wrong never hurt anyone. We've got bad habits that say, well, that's just the way I am, so like it or lump it, because I don't give a monkey's what anyone else thinks. I hope all these sayings, by the way, work in every culture of our church and every culture everybody else has come from, because I'm always aware that I might say something that might offend another culture. I've made so many mistakes over the years going into other cultures to preach, and I've said something that's perfectly acceptable in ours, and people look. I can't believe your pastor just said that. So we've got bad habits. Don't give a monkeys. That does work in our culture. Hopefully it works where you come from. And serious addictions keep pulling you back, selling you the lie that there's no way you can do without them in your life, because you're not strong enough to let go. So we desperately need the help of others in terms of accountability and the help of the Holy Spirit to make us see and set us free. Because think about it, the Bible says the truth will set you free. We can't see that we need to be set free, and we won't get free. We got to see it. It's all about revelation today. If you're sat there thinking it's for someone else and not for you, you're not going to get any revelation about what God wants to speak into your life right now. I pray that God would show you today, that you have a personal Jesus moment again, if you've not already had it this morning, to show you where some of this stuff might be occurring in your life, not to make you feel bad, but to set you free. So that if you will see it, it will set you free, and you will get free indeed. So here's the real deal. We've got to get revelation of where we're at. Revelation is the change agent, because revelation starts the revolution. So before we finish, just in case you think I've forgotten, I talked last week about the fact that we were going to have a testimony of someone very close to us who went to level 4 several years back and stayed there for quite a while. And they graciously offered to share their testimony. They graciously offered to share their story with you so that it will help you to understand just how easily to get to level 4, but also as an encouragement never to do that and never to see what happened in this person's life. Watch this.
So Pastor Mike has been talking over the last few weeks about level thinking. Those three levels have been thoughts, high things, and arguments. And we've heard about how our thinking can lead us to those different levels, and how if we don't take control of our thoughts, then they can really develop into number 4, level 4, which is strongholds. So Sean, you were going to share with us. Can you talk us through how a thought became a stronghold for you?
Yeah, it was It's interesting because it seems to take you so fast and you don't realise where it's going. So the background was that there was a situation going on and we were working with the pastors through it, and Pastor Mike said something. Mm-hmm. And the line that he said and the line that I heard were two very different lines. Okay. I was in not a great place anyway. I mean, we often talk about going round and round the mountain. I mean, my mountain had a rut. I was going round and round it so many times. And so it didn't take much for me to drift very quickly from thoughts into high things. And when you hit that level, and then you think that you're right, and everything, you know, I must be right because that's what I heard. And what started to happen was it began to impact my relationship with Sadie. It began to impact my relationship with Pastor Mike and Pastor Lois to a certain extent. But it also began to impact my relationship with God and also my relationship within the church. Mm-hmm. But the more you go on, the more things happen. So one of the things that really happens is that you find common ground with other people. So if somebody else has got a slight niggle over something, it's like birds of a feather. So all of a sudden you find other people who think the same way as you, and then you are right, then you must be right, you know, because you can justify this and you can put this point of view across. And my biggest issue is in this whole situation was that I don't argue. I'm not a big arguer. But what I do is I keep very quiet in scenarios, and I know that Pastor Mike found that quite difficult because he was trying to talk to me about what was going on, and I was just sending up a brick wall because I was right, and that whole pride thing had jumped up. And then the arguments, in that argument stage, and the argument stage, you're arguing with yourself constantly. There's one side of you that's saying that this is what he said, and the other side of you is saying that it can't be what he said. And so you have this constant battle inside you. But then you begin to argue with those around you. And if we'd sat down and had a chat with the pastors, and then I was very calm and very quiet and nothing was dealt with, and then we would go home, and on the way home I would be arguing. Because the one person that I could then bite back at is the one person in Sadie who was there. And then you suddenly find that you are in a position where you don't know how to get out of it. You don't want to get out of it because you know that you're right, and you know what you heard, and this is the scenario, and this is what's going to happen, and I am going to do this, and I'm going to be like that, and nobody can do this because I am right. And at that point, that's when you hit the stronghold, because now this thought is all-encompassing, and my entire existence around church was turn up, set up, do it, go home. And I never took anything away from those. And this is a long time. This went over a long time. And it was just literally the whole process of just existing. I just turn up and I do it and I go home. And Monday to Saturday, I'm fine. Okay, but don't ask me to do anything for church or anything else, because up it goes, up it goes.
Okay.
And you realise that all of a sudden, you know, when you look back, you realise at that point, you'd completely lost control of your thought process, and you were completely entombed in this place that was very difficult to see a way out of.
So what do you think actually kept you there in that stronghold?
Pride is the first one. It's got such a big hold on you. It's that I'm right mentality. And it goes from being, you know, right at the beginning, it's like, did I hear that? At that point, you should address it. Sorry, did I hear you correctly? Is that what you said? But you don't. You don't address it. You tuck it away. And then something else might be said a bit later on. And you're like, oh, yeah, well, you said that. And now you said that. And then you begin to put these other things in line. And, you know, and at that point in time, it was like I had an enemy. And I mean that in the past, not now, obviously. But Pastor Mike was like, right there, and he just wouldn't back down, but I wouldn't back down, and there was like this impasse between the two of us. And I would say things to Sadie like, well, they won't kick me off team, I want to get kicked off team, you know. And I could have walked out of church on numerous occasions, but I knew that leaving church wasn't the right thing to do, because if I did, I'd lose Sadie, and that's the one thing that I didn't want to do. Out of all of this, the one thing that was important to me wasn't church, it was Sadie. The one thing that was brought into Sadie was church, so therefore you go to church.
Mm.
And you do church because you want to be with the person that you love, and from Monday to Saturday you love them dearly, and on Sunday they're a bit annoying because your entire focus is around the fact that you are in a place you don't want to be.
Mm.
And, you know, the pastors were incredibly gracious, phenomenal, we'd say. And I can't imagine how difficult it was from their side.
Mm.
Because I did not give an inch for a long, long time. You know, and I'm sure there were times that, I know there were times, because we've talked about it, when they sat down and said, that's it. And then they've gone, no. We need to hang in there. And I'm just grateful that they did.
Definitely. So how did God intervene to pull you back from that stronghold then, Sean?
Okay, you can't write this down. This this is ridiculous. So it must be God. So we were going to see Anastasia in concert at Cardiff. And we had tickets. And we knew that the pastors were going. And I'm like, well, that's fine. Because it's X amount of thousand people in Cardiff, we're never going to see the pastors. And then we pulled up in the car park next to the Cardiff Arena. Sadie pulls into the parking space, and as we're getting out the car, the pastors pretty much pull in next to us in the parking space. And it was like, you've got to be kidding me. Everything inside me was like, oh, you're having a laugh. The last person I want to see right now is getting out of the car, and they go, hi, and hug, and hi, and I'm like, hello. And then it's like, oh, it's fine, because, you know, we're going to go, and we're going to do different things, and then it's like, oh, no, let's all go for dinner. And it's like, you've got to be kidding me. The last person I want to have dinner with is this person right now. It's like, I mean, that's how strong the feelings were. Hate is a very, very harsh, hard term, and I wouldn't say it was that, but it had definitely gone from a point of respect a long time ago to tolerate. I tolerate your presence. And then from that, there was just no respect at all. And it was just a case of, I want to move on, I want to get out. So we go for a meal. So we sat down having a meal. And Pastor Mike is making polite conversation with me. And I think I'm like probably grunting back. And then it dawns on me, if I pay for the meal, we can get out really quickly. And so I did that. And I went and paid. And I came back and sat down. And they went, I said, no, oh, no, it's done now. And they're like, oh, thank you. It's really kind. I'm like, oh, it's fine. And then it was like one of those sort of films where you have someone behind glass. And then the glass begins to crack. And then little bits of the glass begin to appear. Because one thing that I've always tried to be is generous. And one thing I've always tried to do is bless people. And with the pastors, I've tried to bless them when I can. And so for me, like, we go out for coffee, I'll get the coffee. You know, that's just my heart. That's the way that I am. So amidst all this black rubbish that's going on, there's a tiny speck of light that's going, pay for the meal. And I'm thinking, well, that's me getting out. And actually what it was doing was beginning to open up.
Yeah, I see.
And so we then started walking down towards the arena where the concert was. And conversation started very lightly, very light touch. And it was like, literally, it was like someone was just stripping everything away that was there. And I started to see my friend and my pastor again.
Yeah.
Whereas before, all I could see was a block that was in front of me that I just wouldn't get out of my way. The really hard thing then was that guilt is kicking in now. So I'm now seeing what I've done, and I can see what I've done to Sadie, and I can see what I've done to other people, and it's beginning to, it's like this mist is lifting. Swimming straight in is guilt. So I'm now fighting guilt, and I'm doing this. And we had a chat just as we got inside. We had a chat and we began to talk through it. And I just talked, and then we realized there's a concert. We hugged it and then went and did the concert. And then afterwards we came back and we were talking from I think pretty much the moment we left the arena and we walked around into the car park, and then we talked in the car park, and it was freezing cold. I know that because my wife is like this, us both like this. And they're both getting in the car, past Mike, and I just talked and talked and talked and talked. And it just began to disappear. And God was just flashing in, like, with his grace and his mercy right there. And the grace that I'd been shown by other people was what was flashing back at me. And it was like just washing all of this away. But to get back down from that stronghold down to ground level, the biggest thing was willingness.
Yeah.
And it's about how you allow God to do that. And God will do that.
Mm-hmm.
And he'll find those things. And with me, it was something that seemed so practical. And yet, everything just began to unravel in a good way
mm-hmm.
from that point onwards. And that wasn't the end of it. You know, we sat down and we talked a lot. And the first thing I said to them is, okay, I'm stepping down and I'm doing this. The first thing they said is, you know, we didn't make you step down. We're not going to let you step down. And it's about them being able to have someone around that you can make yourself accountable to
mm-hmm.
for when those things come around again. And because the movement down is just as difficult as seeing the movement up, because mm-hmm. you're fighting that inside of you that says, I'm not good enough. I'm not good enough for this. I'm not worthy of this. And I said that for ages afterwards, you know, I'm not good enough for that. And then you've got to fight that, because that could then become a stronghold.
Yeah,
exactly. You know, it's almost like the devil's gone, well, you got rid of that one, mate, but I'm going to throw this one at you now. And so you have to surround yourself with people that care for you and will talk into your life and speak into your life in that way. And I'm just thankful they never gave up, you know, because I think it would be a very different person. Well, I wouldn't be here, and I probably wouldn't have a marriage, and we wouldn't have Toby because this is pre-Toby when this took place. So that's my okay. story.
Okay, thanks so much for sharing, Sean, really appreciate it.
To say thank you to Sean. I want to say thank you to Sean for sharing that. Let me just tell you something from my perspective. And I was looking yesterday for my journal and I couldn't find it. I put it somewhere in the loft, and our loft needs clearing out. But I remember what I put in my journal. And there were days when I would come to church and go home again, and Sean wouldn't speak to us. And whatever I tried, it seemed to make things worse. Those Sundays were some of the hardest I've ever navigated as a pastor. He touched on the fact that birds of a feather flock together. And I don't know whether he remembers this, but we had an associate pastor at the time who was not actually an associate pastor at that time, but he'd been an associate pastor. And he also was going through something. And so I had Sean not speaking to me. And I had this guy who was also doing our sound with his head on the sound desk throughout the entire service, not wanting to be there. Some of the leaders are nodding their head because they were there. And it was so painful. It's like, how do you get through to someone that you don't know why you've upset them, because they've heard something you've never said, and now they've allowed it to become this stronghold? And, you know, what I want to do in ending today is not to dwell on the negative, because the negative is in the past. The positive is that Sean got set free in the name of Jesus. Come on, that's worthy of praise. That right now is worthy of you getting on your feet and giving God praise for his grace and his mercy, and the fact that there is no power that can keep someone down. There is no power that can keep someone down. While you're standing, just stay standing. We're going to finish. I want to encourage you to honestly evaluate and ask yourself, where am I today? Where have I allowed myself to travel? What level am I really on? How easily would you be led into conversation about, for example, your pastors if someone had a niggle in the church? Let's touch on something that Sean openly admitted. How easily you could be drawn into that conversation, because I've seen it happen so many times. Good people suddenly drawn in. Suddenly the pastor's their enemy. And suddenly their mouth goes because their thoughts haven't been captured and they've gone down a road. And if you've done that with either me or another pastor, I'm not saying all this to make you feel bad right now, but what I want to do is try and help you stop that ever happening again, because there are serious consequences for us. There are serious things that go on when we entertain the enemy's lies. And there were years that Sean missed out on because he entertained that thought. He said it himself, and one of the things that we were so precious about and worried about was his marriage. Sadie continued to serve as a children's pastor through this time. Oh, she offered so many times to give up because she was ashamed of what was going on. And we said, this is not you. Yeah. Equally, we wouldn't let Sean give up either, because we knew that would send him out the door. Yeah. But I want to say this to you today. Where are you at? Come on, come with me. Come with Sean. Sean, come up here and minister with me. Come with me. Come with Sean. Let's go down to ground level. Let's go down to where Sean went, God's level. And let's do what it says in Romans 12 verse 2 to do. Don't copy the behavior and customs of this world, but let God transform you into a new person by changing the way you think. I like the way the Passion Translation puts it. Stop imitating the ideals and opinions of the culture around you, but be inwardly transformed by the Holy Spirit through a total reformation of how you think. Yeah. This will empower you to discern God's will as you live a beautiful life, satisfying and perfect in His eyes. So reformation, a reformation of revelation, empowers us to discern God's will and live God's way. Let's do what we talked about a couple of weeks ago. Let's put some mind management in place. Let's put some thought replacement therapy in place. Let's change the channel of our thinking. Let's not do that just as a one-off, but let's do that as an ongoing process. So that every time we get a thought that doesn't sit right or fit right, we need to change it in order to stay right.
Amen.
Sean, if he'd been thinking right, would never have gone to that place. And when he did start thinking right, it only took a moment. It only took one thought. He entertained one right thought, and God said, I can work with that. I can work.
Sounds okay.
So today you don't need to be mastered by wrong thoughts. What have you thought about people? What have you thought about yourself? You don't have to be enslaved by a destructive thought pattern or lifestyle anymore. You can break habits. If we've got people and you're tuning in right now and you've got addictions or you've got things that have become really bad habits, you can be set free in the name of Jesus. Come on, Sean, pray for these people online.
Lord, we thank you today that nothing is impossible for you.
Amen.
We thank you that you can just turn situations around. And if you're watching today, if you're online and you're watching, or if you're here and you're watching and you've got that niggling thing in the back of your head that's just going, do you know what, I need to deal with this, then deal with it. Just deal with it, because it just gets bigger and bigger and bigger and bigger, and then eventually it becomes all-consuming. And Lord, we pray for those people who might be online right now who are watching, who've had issues with churches, and maybe that's why they're not in church today.
Right.
And we just pray that you can go back and put that right. It doesn't mean you go back to the church necessarily, but by putting it right, it means you can move on and move into something else where God wants you. And we pray for those people with addictions, whatever they might be, that you would just lay them down.
Yeah.
but that you would seek help, and not help from the world, but help from the church, help from people who can pray with you and stand alongside you and be with you in every situation. We pray for those people who need healing right now, and that healing is, your illness has become all-consuming, completely taken over everything about you, and you've become your illness. And Lord, we just pray for right mind. We pray that you would just change people's lives and change their focus, and that this all-consuming illness that's taken over their life will just be put to one side, and your healing can come through. And Lord, more importantly, we just pray for those hearts that are broken. I really pray for those hearts who are broken. If you're watching online, if you're here and you've been through situations where you've been hurt, whoever that might have been by, and however that was and whenever it was in your life, I just pray the ability to lay that down. And to realize that God can put people around you who won't hurt you. But I pray, more importantly, Lord, that as you wash out all of the rubbish, you'll replace trust. I really feel that there are people here, as well as online, who you need trust. You need to trust people, and really trust people. And it might just start with one or two, but eventually it will grow. And you don't ever have to trust everybody. It's not about having everybody, because we're all given people who we work with and God places alongside us, but it's about putting that trust there and saying, I'm making myself vulnerable. Because last time you did it, it hurt. But that doesn't mean you stop. So Lord, I just pray now for a breakthrough in people's lives. I pray that if something's changed in you today, that you would just let us know. Whether you're online or here, just let us know so that we can share that amazing breakthrough. And Lord, I just thank you that you never give up. But I also thank you that you give people to people who never give up. Amen. So this whole message series has been a journey for all of us. And, you know, there's people online or there's people here. And if you are sat there going, do you know, right now, inside me is rubbish and turmoil and it's just horrible, and how can I be anything like you're saying? How can I be pure and holy? How can I have this love that you're talking about? And you see, the thing is, when Jesus went to the cross, he took all of that. When he was on the cross, when he was standing there, when he was nailed onto the cross, and he was arms stretched out, and the pain was flowing through him, and his life was disappearing, and there are two thieves either side of him, and one of them starts shouting at him, but the other one says, I'm really sorry. I'm rubbish. I'm really sorry. And Jesus turns and says to him, today you will be with me in paradise. At that last point, in that last moment, as his life was ebbing away, he's reached out to somebody who just the world saw as rubbish. And he went, come with me. Come with me. And that's what he's saying today. He's saying, come with me, come with me. You might think that your life is rubbish. You might think that the situations that you've been through, you're not worthy. Truth is, none of us are worthy. We're only worthy because between this hill over here where human life was and this hill over here where God watched it, Jesus stepped into the gap and he stretched out his arms and he died and he left the bridge so that we can walk across back into God's presence and say, I know I'm not worthy, but I'm a friend of Jesus. And God says, come in, come in. And Jesus whispers into God's ear, hey, he's really cool, she's really cool, they're really cool. So if you've never accepted Jesus into your life, I just pray today that something in your heart would now be going, do you know what, I want this. It's not about recognition. It's not about me, me, me. It's about you, Lord. So Lord Jesus, we thank you that you give us the opportunity to come into your presence. We thank you that you stretched your arms out and that you died. so that we might be able to have everlasting life. We thank you that you rose again. We thank you that you sent your Holy Spirit to be with us, and we just pray, Lord, just pray for those people who don't know you. I just pray right now that you will open their hearts to this loving, caring God who just wants to wrap their arms around them and say, I love you, come over. So Lord, we just give you our lives. We thank you that we can say that and know that it's just simple words, but when our heart is open, the change is made. Amen. If you've made that decision online, please get in contact with us. Please let us know, because we would love to hear your story, but also to make sure that you've got people around you, to put you in touch with people who can care and look after you. And church, just keep your eyes closed. And if anybody prayed that first time, or if anybody prayed that as a recommitment today, because we can do that, then just raise your hands today. Because God knows inside your heart what's going on. Thank you. Thank you. Amen.
There is always hope, church. Always hope. There's a living testimony here. How we can get back in the elevator and get back to God. Amen. Let's give him the glory. Let's give him the thanks. To celebrate.
I believe it, that in this moment we are seeing.